Last week, maybe because I talked to my cousin. Well, anyway, the name of this poem is called Are You There? And I remember when she struggled with some personal challenges, and she said, all I ever wanted to do was have children and have a, you know, get married and have children and just have a family and have a house. And then all of these things started happening. She made some bad decisions and she went through so much stuff. And when she died, I would find out 2 days later, but two days before finding out, this poem literally dropped into my head and I lost my balance and I had to grab something near me. And I rushed to the computer and I wrote this poem. And it's like when you're questioning God with all the things you're going through. And I remember sitting with her and she was like, this is all I ever wanted. And these things are happening. And some of the things she brought on herself, but it's called Are You There? It's also a song that Gary Germany put some words to, and it goes, are you angry? Are you laughing? Do you feel me? Do you care? Do you see me shaking? I'm gonna just do the poem. Are you angry? Are you laughing? Do you feel me? Do you care? Do you see me shaking, breaking? Are you listening up there? Did you make me just to break me? Was I born just to die? Do you see me, God, dying, crying? Do you even bat an eye? Are you wondering what I'm doing? Is this quest for life a test? Do you see me shrinking, prinking? Why you leave me in this mess? Do you enjoy my pain? Does my shame bring you gain? Do you see me hurting, bleeding? Are you there? Where? Oh, where? If you're near me, God, do you feel me? God of everywhere, come quickly, ever swiftly. Never leave me in despair. Come in my heart and stop the breaking. Come in my spirit and set me free. Come in my soul and bring deliverance. Come in my mind and bring me peace. When peace like a river. You know, we're going through some stuff, and everybody has different dynamics in terms of how this situation has affected us. And sometimes we're laughing, and sometimes we're crying, and sometimes we see the benefit of it, and sometimes we wonder, God, like, what's up? And we say, God, are you angry? Do you love me? And yes, he does love us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. And that was the poem from, it's called Are You There? It's also a song, okay, that I'm going to put out. Okay, so I shared this before, and after sharing that really heavy one, I'm going to remind you of this one, and it's called Vacation in My Mind, because you might not be able to, because we're quarantined, you know, normally they quarantine people who they know have an infectious disease, right, or animals and people, like, but we are not sure, but we're keeping ourselves safe so we don't flood the health services. Okay, so we can't go many places, you know, and if you do, it's curbside, so you've got to go back home and deal with people that you haven't been used to being around for a long time, so you might want to practice this going on a vacation in your mind. I'm going on a vacation in my mind to another space in time. I'm going to steal away today. Till I hear my own self just breathing, just so that I can remind myself that I'm okay, that I'm still here, that I'm still here, that I'm still here. Maybe it's you tripping. You see, yes, I'm gonna pack my bags and say goodbye without ever really leaving to all that is bothering you. Ain't bothering me, too. I'm going on a vacation in my mind, and I ain't taking you. You know, and then you can go on a vacation in your mind, and you can just be your own PR person. You can put a spin on that. And so whatever good things are good and decent, a good report, you can think on these things. And then and it's okay to have a spirit of sometimes reciprocity, you know, like, you know, sometimes you're upset about something. You might go through your head and say something. It doesn't sound like a real Christian, but, you know, even David, he had some times when he talked about his enemy and lay him low, God, and get him, you know, because he was just venting, and that happens sometimes. So I'm going to share this one, and that was from Uplifted. I'm going to share this. Is from Soulsworth, okay? And most of the concepts in this poem is about the law of sowing and reaping. So this is when somebody's really getting on your last nerve. And you want to say something nice, but it's kind of spin on it, okay? You hear it? It says, they do not know what they do. And by the way, we're studying Esther this week in Sunday school, and we'll see what happens to Haman. It's one of kind of those things, he kind of reaped what he sowed. They do not know what they do. Have mercy on my enemies, for they do not know what they do. For God says, I will contend with those who contend with you. Have mercy on my enemies, for they have sealed their fate indeed, for it's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of an angry God. Yes, fall into, and then I say, yes, fall into the hands of an angry God. Bless my enemies, oh, do please, for what will soon befall them will bring them to their knees. Oh, give them a chance to know your mercy and repent before they receive your wrath. And be no more for the error of their ways. Yeah, be no more for the error of their ways. Please allow me to do good to those who despitefully use me, that they may have an example in the earth of God's love and the blessing of the golden rule, because as you do unto others, you certainly will certainly revisit you. Yeah, later. Certainly revisit you with seed bearing fruit. Revisit you later with seed bearing fruit. Okay, so basically I'm sounding really sincere, but on the other end I want to say get them. Sometimes we have an excess event, God knows it, but we got to repent, you know, because we do some wrong things too. If your enemy only knew what they did to you, they did to themselves too, they would seek to bless you and not mess with you. If your enemy only knew. Oh, Austin, I'm hoping that this continues to go. Forgive me, guys. I'm having some things going on with phone calls coming through. Okay, I'm good. If your enemy only knew if your heart only knew what it desired to own could be released as we bestowed it on another soul. If we would see, it would cease to hoard possessions and give without concessions if your soul only knew. If we only knew the truth that men walk as trees bearing fruit, that they would plant themselves by living waters till the true vine springs forth and healing for the nations, they too would find shalom, shalom. Nothing missing, nothing broken. I don't know if this is freezing up. I'm having some power things going on here. Okay. I see. Hi, Ray Ray. Hi, Sister Sheila. And this is for my children, okay? This is for children everywhere. It says, may the love of God overwhelm you. It's a blessing to give. May the revelation of God penetrate you. May the peace of God saturate you. May the kingdom of God establish you. And may you come to experience his highest good in every area and every endeavor of your life. But that's what we want for our children. But despite what we want, things happen and they go through life, and sometimes it's simply a relationship that may throw things off for them and a sense of worth and who they are. This is called free to go, and then I'm going to do starvation, okay? It's kind of combined. I have an opportunity to share a book that my sister, a friend of mine wrote, and it says, is he your boo or your boo-boo? Okay. And so these kind of poems would go with that, okay? Because we might have experience. Hi, Ken. How are you doing? And you're not a boo-boo. You are a nice man. Good to see you, Ken. Good to talk to you, okay? You tried to make me the canvas of your self-hatred and every lousy thing that happened to you, and I played along. You tried to make me feel dead inside so that I can be the repository of your misery, and I oddly accepted the task, accepted the role. And the funny thing is I allowed myself to think that I needed to earn your love when you didn't have the wealth of self-love to give, and I loved you still. You were so busy camouflaging your own insecurity, you didn't know how loving me would set you free, and I bore your chains. And because you refused to learn from your mama's wounds, you couldn't conquer your daddy's demons, and I attempted the task. And so you took crude instruments of resentment and contempt, and you etched your pain on my heart, and your soul miles away from my love. And because you didn't choose to love me, you set me free to go. That's also a song too. It's called Free to Go. Something I worked with Gary Germany on. Remember the the ones, the Oliver, when he says, "More, please. More, please." Okay. So he was being starved. And there's all kind of starvation. You can starve your mind by not reading. You can starve your spirit by not feeding your spirit. You can starve relationships by not giving them time. You can starve a plant. You can starve an animal by forgetting to feed it, you know, and by not attending to it. So in this time, we're finding that we have time to feed things we haven't fed, to spend time with family members and to think about them and make calls and do things that you hadn't had time to do. But now you have time. So this is called starvation. When I wrote this, I think I rolled out of the bed and I might have been feeling this way. And, you know, people who are, sometimes people who are married, sometimes are lonely too, you know. Because sometimes our spouses, we get so busy and we don't attend to each other. Needing too much of the things I want. Wanting too much of the things I need. Help somebody. Rescue me. Remind me what it's like to be a child, happy, fed, secured, and cared for. I'm wishing for more than I'm getting. I'm dreaming for more. I cannot rest. Stop. Somebody know me. Tell me what it's like to be a woman held, appreciated, and looked at the time. I'm hurting so much. I can't stand it. I'm in such pain. I can't bear it. Please. Someone see me, show me what it's like to be a person. Still here, hoping, surviving, and expecting more, please. When you pass, sometimes I see children when I'm working and at the schools, and I look behind their eyes, and I see a sadness in their eyes. And I hear stories where they might have seen someone commit suicide, or they feel the parent doesn't love them, and they share something. And I'm sure they're looking at it from their perspective. But some of them have some legitimate experience. There's somebody around you that's starving. Just for a little affirmation, for a smile, for it's going to be okay, baby. And if you can, in the fullness of your soul, give them something. And don't miss that behind their eyes, and they say, "I'm okay," but they're really in need of something. So now I'm just going to open this up and see what I get. Ooh, I got something. It says, "Excuse me, I'm about to be free. I just may dance on your feet. Watch me, I'm coloring out the line. Kept me, box me in, because I'm too sublime. Excuse me, I must be old, so bold, for I found this joy down in my soul. So I'm calling off my search party for you. Never mind. Because I found in myself peace, joy, love, and truth. I found all of this inside of me. So you excuse me, because I intend to be free. Watch me now. I might just dance on your feet." That's from this book here. Excuse me. Dance is so liberating. So I'm hoping you're dancing. My sons and I would dance a lot. I posted something with my son dancing today. And we dance. I grew up in a family in Chicago when we were dancers. I mean, there would be a funeral, and we'd be at my aunt's house, and we turn on Motown, and we have Soul Train lines. We were dancing. And I dance anytime I hear music most often. And I even dance in church, and so I wrote a book about that. That's another story. But anyway, so this one is called, it's called Free to Be Me, okay? And I'm so comfortable free to be me that I could be dancing alone and say, "What is her trip?" But I'm free to be me. Because there's no reason why I can't be who I am, and you be who you are, and they be who they think they wanna be this week. And there's no reason for me to be less of me. So you comfortable hanging with more of them who don't know who they are anyway? And there's no reason for your darkness to hide my light when I realize there's night and day between us, and you choose to stay that way, and I choose to be free. It's okay, because I'm free to be me. That's also on YouTube, a channel I need to update, and Gary Germany put the music behind that too, Free to Be Me, okay? Now I want to say some loved ones. A friend of mine got married. Unfortunately, they didn't stay married long, but he wanted me to write a poem, and I wrote a poem for him, and it's called Reaching Through You to Love Me. Oh, I'm having a hot flash. You see that? Okay. "As I look into your eyes, I see my Lord. And as I touch as you touch my hair, my face, I feel God's hand. As I look into your heart, I see his love reaching through you to love me." Yeah. See, as I feel the, I can feel the hand of God reaching through you to love me. And as I work, as you worship and praise God, I love you more. As you expound upon his word, I see the light. And as you kneel beside me, pray beside me, I feel his power. And I know he reaches through you to love me. And as you tell me of your love, I hear his voice. And as you share his plan for us, I know the truth. And as you walk beside me, sleep beside me, dream beside me, share your seed inside of me, I reach through you to love my God. Because, you know, actually, I did say seed. And actually, when you are married, that marriage bed is like the altar. So because you reach through me to love God, I reach through you to love God. Let us choose each day to reach God through our love. Because that's really what it was all about. It was all about love. And when Adam said something wrong with Eve that you gave me, you know, Jesus became that new Adam. And he began to show us the how to love it and give us a heart that we would be more receptive to love. In fact, that's really what the church should be, an example of love in the earth and God's love for the church. Okay, and that's what women, a husband and a wife should exhibit, that agape, unconditional, tenacious, pugnacious, stubborn love that won't go away. Here's one. You're the poem inside of me that's still being. You're the poem in my life that's still being written. You're the song in my life that's still being sung. You're the dream of my dreams, and I'm still dreaming. You're the mathematical equation that grants me infinity and makes me one. This is called To My Boaz Lover. Let me come into your garden. Let me glean what you grow. Let me lie at your feet and bid me never go. Sow your seed in my garden so you can know love, and so your soul can find rest and strength to grow as one as he is. Okay, so this is something that we should be cognizant of, and that's that we are seeds, and we're always sowing in our words, our actions, our deeds, our service. And we're sowing things that come back to us. So we're like soul farmers. And we can realize that, you know, every religion has this, you reap what you sow, what goes around comes around. Every dog has his day, do unto others as you have them to do unto you. Every religion has this understanding that sometimes how we treat other people indicates what's going on in our soul and also tells us what we're going to receive down the road. So it behooves us to be nice to people, just be nice, and set an example for children. It goes like this, after its own kind. What you desire your children to be, you must first bear it on your own tree. Because you're the fruit. You are the first fruit your children will seed from. And you are the first garden they will graze upon. And if you want them to walk in love and peace, you should first exemplify it in your actions and speech. And if you want them to grow strong and wise, you must be mindful of the life you live before their eyes. For you are the first garden that will nurture them for a life of righteousness or a life of sin. It depends on what you feed your soul that will determine the destiny they will unfold. You can try to blame it on others if things don't go quite right, but God knows what you did right on the clean slate you received from the life you conceived. Don't take all the credit if it turns out all right, too. Look back and know that someone influenced your life, for as God designed, we produce after our own kind. Don't despair if you made a mistake. We can all repent and see change in grace and become in one moment what God intended if we accept Jesus with a heart repentant. Okay, and how much time do I have? Okay, I have a question for you. You are in school right now, everybody. You know what I noticed too? Although, and I want to thank all of you that stayed at home and you're not roaming out there and you're helping to help flatten the curve. But as I've been flattening the curve, and helping to flatten the curve, I have been enlarging my own curves. Thus, we have this blocking all of me. Okay, here's a question. Okay, as you guys know, I'm a substitute teacher, so and a Sunday school teacher, so I'm teaching here, and I'm going to start with a question. A good teacher sometimes starts with a question to activate the mind. And I want to know this: can you lose and still win? Can you find a lover and keep a friend? Can you disagree and stay at one? Can you find peace in the state of war? Can you teach and not preach? Can you correct and not condemn? Can you desire and not covet? Can you advise and not control? Can you move and be at rest? Can you move and be at rest? Can you change and remain unchanged? Can you laugh and stay alert? Can you cry and still rejoice. Can you see the light in the dark? Can you feel the sun in the rain? Can you know the joy in the midst of pain? Can you stay a child as you become a man? Can you know me and see you? Can you see me and know you? Can you respond to God? I'm hoping this is not stopping. I'm going to have to start really soon, guys. Okay? Okay, you're still there? Can you still hear? Okay, I'm going to go back a little bit. It says, can you know joy in the midst of pain? Because there's so much going on. And we're feeling the pain of others, and that we see the joy of others too. But can you know joy in the midst of pain? And it all depends on if you know the source of joy. Can you stay a child as you become a man? Can you know me and see you? Can you see you and know me? Really? That's just over in China. That's somewhere else. And now we're seeing and knowing what they know. Maybe we ought to get there first, you know, living not so distant from one another, but more empathetic. Can you respond to God as you treat your fellow man? Can you seek him with your whole heart and find him where? Within. Can you answer that question? I can. I think I have a few more minutes, and I'm thinking about grabbing something from Uplifted. Okay? And this is right inside of you. I fell in love with you when you weren't even looking. See, you didn't see me standing there, though you were running my way. And you searched high and low. And you would never guess how close you were to all you ever really needed. You see, I've always loved you, but you refused to know it. You gave away the things I gave you like you know what you had. And all the time, I stood there knocking. Knocking, just hoping for you to respond. You kept running, seeking out other gods, and I was right in sight of you, loving you still, loving you real. Now, this comes from the book Uplifted, and every poem has about 7 to 15 questions to engage, to stretch it out, to if you want to use it as a part of a speaking or but it says it could be used for book clubs, self-exploration. So with that, I said, show how you missed out on a good thing because you were too busy to notice. Have you overlooked or taken for granted something or someone who was really close to you and cared for you? I did that with God, you know. And then I realized, oh my God, you were there all along, loving me and being patient with me. That's really what that poem is about. But you can make it about whatever you want to make it about. And I said, what is the color of unrequited love and how does that feel? You know, I sang a song the other day. Remember Roberta Flack, she used to sing, where is love you said you give to me? Do you think God ever thinks about where is this love? He sent his only begotten son. Where is this love? You know, where is this love? And then it takes something for us to slow down and say, oh, God, help us. You know, and he's there all alone and being ignored, you know. So I think I have like one more minute, and I'm trying to share. I have some stuff on my YouTube. Oh, I'm going to send this to, I know Ken was out there, and he represents an Asian guy, and God bless him. And I think, but this is to African-American men, and I wrote it when I saw a man come into the store, and I said, hey, brother, how you doing? And he said, trying. I was like, that's kind of a different kind of answer. But I didn't know all the dynamics and what he was going through. And although we pretend to know, no matter what color the man is, you know, they deal with some different things, you know, and all of us. But this is in celebration of African-American men. And I want to remind you, as soon as we're past this pandemic and you can go to the hospital, make sure you have your prostate checked out. Said, I love all those black men, all those brothers and fathers and somebody's sons who climbed and crawled and dreamed and schemed and fought and failed and lied and tried, who are messy, messed up, and messed over, who still just trying to keep their heads together. I love all those black men who've loved themselves too much, too little.